it going? I'm William Cooper. I am the director of the online executive MBA program here at Faulkner. I'm also the assistant professor in the College of Business. And with me is Will Collins. Will Collins has served as a gas station attendant, a youth minister, a worship minister, and now you are lead minister at Hunter Hills Church in Franklin. So thanks for joining us, Will. Will and I have a lot in common. We both have magnificent beards. We both attended Faulkner as undergraduate students about the same time, and we are both currently PhD students. So Will is studying systematic theology, which I don't know what that is, and I am studying business analytics,
and I don't know what that is.
So whenever I'm reading Bible stories to my kids and they ask me a question and I don't know the answer, I say, go ask Mr. Will. And whenever Will's kids go to him and have questions about their unstructured data sets and how to draw
business insights,
they say, go
see Mr. Will.
That's right. Yeah. So, Will, why are we here?
Well, that's a very deep question, William. I didn't know we were going to be addressing such existential questions as that. There's a lot of disagreement on why we're here and what the meaning of life is.
I mean, why are we here today?
Oh, here today. I'm so glad you wanted to start with a joke.
That was good. It went better than expected.
Yeah, I got two laughs. That's more than I expected. We're here today to talk about vocational ministry and our experience as missionaries in China.
That's right. So help us get caught up. I want you to tell us first how you ended up at Faulkner, and then how you got from Faulkner to China, and to make it more of a challenge, there's going to be a time limit. So I want you to do it in under 2 minutes. You know, first 22 years of your life. Thank you.
Yeah, I can do that. I went to a small Bible college when I graduated high school because a friend of mine went there, and I realized that there were no girls there, but I wanted to get married, and so that was a problematic issue for me. And so I moved over to Faulkner because I had friends going there, and there were girls there, and I wish I could say it was deeper than that, but it wasn't. And it worked. I found my wife here, and we were involved with Landmark Campus Ministry, and our campus minister, Wes Gunn, while we were there, transitioned into becoming the missions minister there and overseeing full-time all the mission work. And when my wife and I started dating, one of the first things she said is, I want to do mission work after I graduate, and if you don't want to do that, then maybe we should not be dating. And what do you think I said to that? Of course I want to do mission work.
Yeah.
Never thought about it a day in my life. because of her desire that it had been on her heart for since she was a freshman in high school. That's how we got involved, and we went to Wes and told him, and then he assembled a team of six people, and we trained together for about 6 months. William was on that team, and in May of 2007, we graduated college. No, you graduated earlier than that, right?
December 06.
We graduated May of 07, Brittany and I got married July of 07, and then we left for China in, August or September, so.
No stress being newly with China, I'm sure.
Oh, no.
We followed similar paths. I grew up in South Texas, small, conservative Church of Christ, and been accepted to Texas A&M, but my older cousin invited me to come for a visit at Faulkner. Came out here, liked it. Well, maybe I'll go for a year or two, do some core classes, and then transfer back home. When I got to Faulkner, that was my first time away from home, and I had to decide what I believed for myself. Not just relied on my parents' faith. So I remember vividly sitting in my dorm room and reading the New Testament, reading about Jesus and his life and his example, because I wanted to, not because it was a Bible class or anything, but I learned about salvation growing up in the church, but I learned about Jesus being the Lord of my life when I was at Faulkner. And so I started looking for opportunities to serve, and I had the opportunity to go on several short-term mission trips while I was at Faulkner, and it was during one of those mission trips where I decided, I want to make a longer-term commitment to serving God. And at one point, Will told me about his plans to go to China and asked me if I wanted to go. And I said, "If you're going, I'll go for a year or two." And the rest is history. I ended up staying for 12 years, met my wife over there, started a family, and really enjoyed it. So, Will, the burning question on everyone's mind about China, what's the most interesting thing you ate while you were over there?
We were hiking through a village out in the mountains one day, and we stopped at this little village, and they were frying up whole minnows, but they were kind of big minnows like that. They just fried them whole, and they handed me one, and I didn't want to be rude, and I just started eating it from the head down. No, that was a bad idea. It was disgusting. I don't know if that's interesting or not, but it's memorable because it was the nastiest thing I've ever put in my mouth. What about you?
I'm sure you have lots of protein.
Oh yeah, lots of good stuff.
The story I remember was from my first year. I was at a night market in Shenyang, where I was the first year, and the nightlife in China is a lot different than in the States. It's more communal. They'll set up these food stalls at night along the road, and you have your choice of interesting foods to choose from. So that evening, I decided to go with the deep fried scorpions. And they were crunchy, kind of like a potato chip. So that was pretty good. All
right. Where am I? We're talking about vocational ministry, right? Oh, I lost my place in the script. What are the biggest differences between life in China and life in America? And you would know. 12 years is a good chunk of time to live in another culture,
right? So, other than food, obviously, which, I love the food. I miss the food. I want to go back just for the food. And, see my relatives. That'd be nice. But food's good, too. So one of the things I really miss about China is the pace of life. In America, everyone's busy. Everyone's got somewhere to be. Slower pace of life. I had more time to spend with my family when I was in China. You run into a neighbor or a friend when you're walking around in China, there's time to check in and see how things are going. In America, it's like, "Hey, how's it going?" "Good, good, I'm good, you good, we're all good in America." Everyone's good. So. Another thing was public transportation. So we lived near the city center. We could walk to the supermarket, walk to restaurants, take taxis, public buses anywhere in the city. Train travel was easy, convenient from city to city. Those are some of the biggest differences. Of course, there's frustrations, language barrier.
I think I know what you're talking about. I think we're,
yeah. So what about you? Any differences? Or?
A lot of walking in China, a lot of walking. I lost 30 pounds the first year, and I didn't even try. I ate whatever I wanted, but it was just, you walk so much.
Right, yeah, cool. Well, you mentioned vocational ministry. That's what we're here to talk about. So give us your definition. What is vocational ministry, and how did you see it play out in China?
I think the definition we're working with here with vocational ministry is seeing your career as primarily ministry, secondarily a way to make money, secondarily a way to accomplish whatever whatever personal goals you might have, but primarily the job you go into is a ministry, a place that God has sent you. So that I think is the definition that we're working with here of vocational ministry. In China, it was it was clear and obvious. Moving back to the States, it isn't so clear and obvious. Some of you guys probably this year is the first time you're hearing the idea that you move into a career, you have these goals, not primarily for yourself and your own fulfillment, but primarily in obedience to God, to go wherever he sends you. And wherever that is, there you're doing ministry and you're working. In China, it was, that's the only reason we were there. We were English teachers at a university, and every morning you wake up and your mindset is, I am going to teach English, but that's not really why. That's not the first and primary reason why I've gotten out of bed this morning. The primary reason is I'm going to try to begin conversations about Jesus Christ. That's one of the differences we're going to talk about. There it was very intentional. You knew why you were there, and I think one of Mitch's goals for Faulkner for this year and all of the faculty's goal is that we all live that way here now, like we've been sent on a special mission to do something. Because truthfully, we have, by God.
Yeah, I think that's the challenge. How do we move that mindset of being a missionary in China to living in the U.S.? You know, same for me. You know, when you're living in a country where 99% of the people don't know God, it's easy to wake up in the morning and share your faith with those around you. I'll give you one example. You know, we would have groups of students in our homes for movie nights or game nights. And one particular evening, a student pulled me to the side as he was leaving. He said, "I know you. You don't remember me, but I met you a few years ago. I was working at a barbecue restaurant, and you were there eating with your friends." And he went on to tell me, you know, I went on to learn that he had lost his father at a young age, dropped out of school, was back in college trying to get his life on track. And I was able to share with him, I said, "I don't think that's a coincidence that you are a student in my class at this moment in your life." And we were able to study together. He learned about his Heavenly Father and eventually accepted Jesus as his Savior.
It's awesome. One of my favorite ministry moments was we were not allowed to just walk in and just start talking about Jesus. We had to be a little more secretive than that. We were allowed to invite people to our apartments. But when the holidays rolled around, we were in our training, we were told that's a great way to bring up Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is sort of the central point of Christmas, for example. And so if you're teaching a cultural lesson on Christmas, which all of our students were really interested in learning about, that was an opportunity for you to teach Jesus under the guise of teaching about culture. And one day I was going through a lesson about Christmas and about, you know, God becoming man and being sent to die and raised from the dead, save us. And this was our first half. And after that, we were going to take a break, and then we were going to move on to something else. And when we got back in after the break, I asked what they wanted to talk about, and a girl raised her hand and says, "Can you tell us more about Jesus?" Just flat, plain like that, and it just gave me an open door to just be able to say anything I wanted to about Jesus, because it was a question that she asked. That girl went on to be baptized as well. So as we wrap it up, William, the other William, what are your biggest takeaways from your time in China that can help these students think about vocational ministry?
Yeah, so the first one, take time to meet people where they are and see them as God's creation. You know, we run into people every day in China, but even on a Christian university campus like Faulkner, you run into people who are hurting and need to know the love of Jesus. And next, you know, build a support network. It was nice in China that we had teammates that we could go to when we were facing challenges. And we knew we had a church supporting us back home. So I would encourage students to get plugged into a local congregation that's lifting up the name of Jesus together. Another thing, you know, when I lived in China, it's obvious that you're a foreigner. I had a foreign passport, and so it really brought forth that I was a foreign citizen, that my citizenship was in heaven, and I'm part of a heavenly kingdom. And finally, I learned it's not up to me. You know, we didn't convert the entire country to China while we were over there, but I got to see God move in powerful ways while I was there, and it was a blessing to partner with Him in that ministry.
That's great. You know, when we came back from China, I jumped into a youth ministry job, and in working for a church and ministry, you have that same kind of intentional mindset. You're there to minister and to help people. My wife, however, when we got back to the States, I culture shocked really bad going into China. She culture shocked really bad coming back from China. And the reason was is because every day in China felt like a mission. And when she got back, it took her a long time to find what her purpose was, what her mission was back here in the States. And that was a real struggle for her. And I learned that teaches me a lot, which is if you guys you're going to graduate, you're going to go off and do your thing, and you're real excited about that now, and you feel like that's a purpose, that's not going to last. Accomplishing these goals that set you up for success here, that's not fulfilling. It seems like it is now, I remember, but it's really not that fulfilling. Because eventually you get to the point where you say, okay, this is just kind of a circle. I wake up and I work and I get money to do a couple things, and then I go to sleep, and then I wake up and I do it all again, and I'm living to live. And that can be very difficult, and it can be kind of depressing. And so I think this whole approach of thinking about your vocation as ministry is a Christian way of living. It's just being a Christian. You don't wake up each day to make the money, to accomplish the goals you have for yourself, or to buy for yourself the life that you always dreamed of. That's not what a Christian is. A Christian doesn't live to themselves. A Christian doesn't live for themselves. They live for the glory of God. They walk in obedience to God and do what He has for them to do. And so that's my takeaway. If you can train your brain right now that when you wake up and walk out of your apartment or your dorm room, it's not for the class assignments, it's not for your job to make money. Those are ancillary things. What you've woken up for, what you get out for, is to see who God is going to place before you to serve. If it's another believer, to encourage them, to help them with whatever they need. If it's not a Christian, it's the same thing, to serve them and hope to get an opportunity to tell them about Jesus. So I think that's the lesson from China that I would encourage you guys with. We can live that way here. And also, God calls some of you to go overseas and actually be foreign missionaries.
Amen. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your thoughts. Can you close us out in prayer?
Absolutely. Let's pray. Father, we have so much to be thankful for. Right now, I'm mindful of how you call people overseas and the way you arrange things to get the gospel to places that you have designed and you planned. God, we're so thankful. And Father, each Christian in this room today, you know and you have planned out who they're going to cross paths with, where they're going to be located in their lives, Father. And somehow you can hold it all together in your mind of how it all is going to work out. We can't, Father, so we walk by faith and not by sight. And we're just thankful that you're doing this and you're saving people through us. God, I pray for these students that you would help them to have a deep vision for their life that's not about them, but it's about you and your purposes. God, if you can work that into their hearts while they're here at Faulkner, God, then I think the future church looks very, very bright, and so much good is going to be done.